Dear student, welcome in CEC Gurukul Lectures. Today we will discuss in the series of experimental physics, solar cell characteristics. Means today's lecture is to study the characteristics of the solar cell. In this presentation, we will discuss what is the solar cell, what is the theory behind the solar cell, and how it works. Then what type of output we can get by using this experiment. And at the last, we will discuss what are the applications of the solar cell and what are the why's can be asked after the experiment. So we start with the aim of the experiment. The topic is to study the characteristics of the solar cell. On the screen, we are having the setup of solar cell. Here, we are having the mounting bench at which we are having the solar cell. One, number two, we are having a lamp, and third is the kit which contains the voltmeter and ammeter and load resistance. So this is a simple setup of the solar cell experiment. Now what are the aim of this experiment? Here we are having the five aim of the experiment. Number one is we can find out the illumination characteristics by using the solar cell. Number two, we can find the current voltage characteristics. Generally in laboratories, we will determine the current voltage characteristics. This is the important aim of the experiment. Number third is the power load characteristics we can determine by using the solar cell. The fourth area characteristics, we can find that how much area that solar cell cover to give the output. Number fifth is a spectral characteristics that we can obtain from the solar cell experiment. Apart from this, there are the optional aims where number one, the distance versus open circuit voltage we can find out. Moreover, we can find out distance versus short circuit current. Distance means the distance between the lamp and the panel of the solar cell. Then we can find out the open circuit voltage and we can find out the short circuit current. So, and the third optional aim, we can find out the measurement of short circuit current with biasing the solar cell and compare it with the theoretical value obtained from the current voltage characteristics curve. It means there are a lot of experiments. By using this experiment, we can find out the various outputs. So we start with the theory of solar cell. First, we should know what is a solar cell. Basically, solar cell are the solid state devices. These are the PN junctions which converts the sunlight, as the name suggests, solar cell, which convert the solar energy into the electrical energy. Means we are converting the sunlight into the electrical energy, but in the laboratories we use the lamp in place of the sunlight. So the solar cell is a device which convert sunlight, solar energy into the electrical energy through the three step process. What are these three step processes? Number one, first we generate the carrier pairs, electron hole pairs will be generated. Number two, separation of the electron and holes. First, the generation of the carrier pairs where we collect the electron hole pairs. After that, separate the electron hole pairs. And third, collection of the separated carriers. It may be holes, it may be electrons. So these are the three steps to find out the characteristics of the solar cell. First is the generation of the carrier pairs. Number two, separation of the electrons and holes. And third is the collection of the separated carriers. When the solar cell is illuminated, illuminated means when the photon of a particular intensity is incident on the cell. Cell is the panel which generates the electron hole pairs. As the light fall upon a solar cell, electron hole pairs are generated. By diffusion in the material, the electron and holes reaches the junction. There is a junction between the NNP layer, NNP. So these will reach electron and holes reach at the junction. At the junction, the barrier field separates the positive and negative charges carrier. At the junction, these positive and negative charges will separate. Under the action of electric field, electrons minority carriers from a P region are swept into the N region. In this manner, we can get the one-sided N or P output. Similarly, the holes from the N region are swept into the P region. It means we collect the P at a particular point and N at a particular point. So, it leads an increase in the number of holes in the P side and electrons on the N side of the junction. The main aim is to separate the P type and N type of charge carriers. So, we just move the holes towards the P side and electrons at the N side when external energy is supplied. So, the accumulation of the charges on the two sides of the junction produces an EMF. As the charges are accumulated on the P side and N side, and they produce the EMF. And this EMF, because of the photon, that is called the photo EMF. So, the photo EMF is also known as the open circuit voltage, and it is proportional to the illumination. It means it depends upon the intensity of the light source and on the size of the illuminated area. As if we collect the open circuit voltage, then it depends upon the illumination power as well as the size of the illuminated area. Now, when the external circuit is connected across the solar cell terminals, what happened? The minority carriers return to their original side through the external circuit, causing the current flow through the circuit. And then we can have the solar cell behave as a battery. And with the N side as a negative terminal and P side as a positive terminal. And this photo EMF or voltage can be measured with the voltmeter. Now, it's the solar cell behaves as a battery, and N side is represented as a negative terminal and P side as a positive terminal, and the photo EMF or the voltage can be measured with a voltmeter, and then we can find out the voltage. All the solar cell materials used till date are semiconductors, and they are crystalline or amorphous form. Solar cells are made from the semiconductors. A common characteristic of these materials is that they possess a band gap. Band gap means discontinuity, or we can say the range of forbidden values in the energy spectrum. So, mostly solar cells are fabricated from the silicon single crystals. Silicon is not a transparent material for a visible light. Therefore, the surface layer of the cell, which is of the P type, is made extremely thin to enable the maximum light to penetrate the junction, and then we can get the more number of the carriers. So, it is the purpose to make the layer thin. It is desired that the absorption of the light takes place at the junction region, such that the generated electron hole pairs can be separated by the junction wheel before they are lost by recombination. The main purpose to get the maximum number of the charge carriers to get the maximum output. So, these should be separated because they can be lost in the recombination region. So, there is a need to separate the electrons and hole pairs as soon as possible. To enhance the transmission of the light into the material, as anti-reflection coating is given over the P layer, then the thin metallic film vacuum deposited suitably on the both the side of the cell act as a electrode, and that is connected with the output. So now here the open circuit peak value is at the 0.6 volt generated by the solar cell. A silicon wafer is used of the diameter 1 and 4 are used for the fabricating of the solar cell. And in order to enhance the total voltage and the current output, a number of PN junctions are formed on the wafer using a mesh type or the finger like electrode structure. A large number of the PN junctions are deposited on the wafer to get the panel of the solar cell. And using this mesh type of finger electrode structure, we get that work as a solar cell. Now, to increase the power output for the solar cell, it is arrayed into the series or chain or the parallel chain that are interconnected. All the PN junctions are interconnected in the parallel chains. Such as an arrangement is called a solar panel. And in normal uses, the single solar cell is rarely used. We use the panel of the solar cell, and its output is very low in case of the single solar cell. But if we use the array of the solar cell, the output power will increase. So on a single wafer, silicon wafer, large number of the PN junctions are plotted in the form of arrays, and they are interconnected. Now, what are the solar array parameters that are very important in the solar cell experiment? Number one is the VOC, that is open circuit voltage. What is this? This is the maximum voltage that the array provides when the terminals are not connected to any load, when the circuit is open. When the resistance is maximum, then we can get the open circuit voltage, and this is the maximum voltage. That is a VOC. In the next, this value is much higher than the V maximum, which related to the operation of the photovoltaic array, which is fixed by the load. This value depends upon the number of the photovoltaic panels connected together in a series. How many panels we are connecting, it depends, it will give the maximum output of the VOC. Now, second is the ISC. This is one of the important parameter which represent the short circuit current, and this is the maximum current provided by the photovoltaic array when the output connectors are shorted together. It is a short circuit current. This value is much higher than the IMP, which relate to the normal operating circuit current. As the voltage is zero, then we can get the ISC, that is the short circuit current. At the zero voltage, we are having the maximum current value that is represented by ISC, that is a short circuit current. Next is the maximum power point, maximum power output. This led to the point where the power supplied by the array that is connected to the load, batteries, inverters, is maximum value. When we can get the maximum value at that point where the IMP cross VMP is maximum, means when the current into voltage output is maximum, then we have the maximum power point. The maximum power point of a photovoltaic array is measured in the watt or the peak watt. So at a particular point, we are having a maximum power when we are having the cross product of the current and voltage is maximum. So we can get the maximum power point. Now, next is the fill factor, which give also the efficiency of the solar panel. The fill factor determine the quality of the solar cell. So, the fill factor is the relationship between the maximum power that the array can be provided under the normal operating conditions and the product of the open circuit voltage multiplied by the short circuit current. It means, to find out the fill factor, we require the VVOC and ISC, open circuit voltage and the short circuit current we require, and the maximum power just to get the fill factor. So, three points are important to get the fill factor: maximum power, second is the open circuit voltage, and third is the short circuit current. That is, this fill factor value gives an idea of the quality of the array, and closer to the fill factor, approximately equal to the 1. And the more power array can be provided. Typical value of the solar cell, which gives the fill factor, approximately 0.7 to 0.8. Now the next, which is very important, is the efficiency of the solar cell. The percentage efficiency gives the quality of the solar cell. So the efficiency of the photovoltaic array is the ratio between the maximum electric power that the array can produce compared to the amount of solar irradiance hitting the array. Efficiency defined in terms of how much light fall upon a panel and what type of output we are getting, means as compared to the amount of solar light irradiated at the panel and the output electric power generated through that solar light, that define the efficiency of a particular solar cell. How much light we are falling and how much electric power we are generated, that define the efficiency of a solar cell. The efficiency is typically solar cell is normally low, around between the 10 to 12%, is depending on the type of cells we are using. The cells may be of monocrystalline, polycrystalline, amorphous or a thin film, can be used as a solar panel. So the product of the open circuit voltage VOC and the short circuit current ISC is known as the ideal power. That ideal power is defined as VOC into ISC. The maximum useful power is the area of the largest rectangle that can be formed under the VI curve. Largest area that define the power area of the solar cell, maximum useful power. Now if Vm and Im is the value of the voltage and current, with this condition means Vm define the maximum voltage and Im the maximum current, then the maximum useful power defined by the Vm into Im. The similarly, we can find out the fill factor, the ratio of the maximum useful power to the ideal power is called the fill factor. As we see in the equation, fill factor is equal to Vm into Im, that is the maximum power, and divided by VOC into the ISC, that is the ideal power. So fill factor, power divided by VOC, open circuit voltage and short circuit current. And that is defined the ratio of the power divided by the ideal power, that define the fill factor. What is the principle behind the solar cell? As a solar cell is a semiconductor devices which converts the solar energy into the electric energy. It is also called the photovoltaic cell. So the solar panel consists of number of solar cells connected in the series or in the parallel, and then it works and it gives the maximum output as compared to the single solar cell. The number of solar cell connected in the series generated the desired output voltage, and connected in the parallel generated the desired output current. If we connect in the series, the output will be maximum. When connect in the parallel, then the desired output current we will get through these solar panels. The conversion of the sunlight into the electric energy takes place only when the light is falling on the cell of the solar panel. When the light fall upon all the solar cells which is mounted on the solar panel, then we can get the electric energy as output. There are most of the particular applications the solar panels are used to change the lead acid and the nickel cadmium batteries. After that we can convert it into the batteries also. So in the sunlight the solar panel charges the battery and also supplies the power to the load directly. But when no sunlight, then the charged battery supplies are required power to the load. So we store the power in the charged battery. After that we can use it as a load. Now a solar cell operates in somewhat the same manner as the other junction photodetectors. A built-in depletion region is generated in that without an applied reverse bias, and the photons of adequate energy create whole electron pairs. Means as we see that we require the charge, generate the charge carriers, after that we recombine, then we separate. So that done in the depletion region of the PN junction. Then in the solar cell, the pair must be diffused a considerable distance to reach the narrow depletion region to be drawn out the useful current through this. There is a higher probability of the recombination. The current generated by the separated pairs increases depletion region voltage in the photovoltaic effect. When a load is connected across the cell, the potential causes the photocurrent to flow through the load. Then EMF generated by the photovoltaic cell in the open circuit, there is no current is drawn from it, that is denoted by VOC, V open circuit. This is the maximum value of the EMF. When the high resistance is introduced in the external circuit, a small current flows through the panel and the voltage decreases. The voltage goes on falling and the current goes on increasing as the resistance in the external circuit is reduced. Thank you very much.